Welcome everyone to Blender for Beginners, the tutorial series for people who do not know Blender at all and want to learn from the beginning. I'm not going to be assuming they know any of the hotkeys, terminology, or anything like that. This is a true from the beginning style tutorial. And when you look at Blender, it can be pretty confusing. I mean, there are buttons here and here, and you don't know what any of them do yet. So to simplify everything, we're just going to ignore these and look at what's called the 3D viewport. And pretty much everything we're going to be covering in this tutorial will be contained inside this window. So what is it that we're actually going to cover in this video? The first objective of this tutorial is to teach you basic navigation. So that's orbiting, panning, and zooming around our scene. And these are important fundamentals that let us move around the 3D environment. And our second objective is going to be learning the basic transforms. So that's moving an object, rotating it, and also scaling it. And knowing all these things will already let us do a lot in Blender. And to prove it, we're going to try to achieve some kind of goal in this tutorial. In this case, our goal is going to be to create a Tower of Hanoi model. And you can see that this is composed entirely of primitive objects. And this just means it's made out of fundamental objects like cubes and cylinders. And the reason we're going to be making this model specifically is that it really tests our ability to work with basic transforms. So let's actually get started. So when you open up Blender for the first time, you're going to get this default scene. And you can see that we already have three objects, a light, a cube, and a camera. To select any of these objects, we can just left click with our mouse. And we can see which object is selected because it's highlighted in orange. Instead, if we want to deselect something, we can just left click anywhere in the background. If we now want to select multiple things, we can just click and drag over our desired objects. Another way to do this is to just click an object and then hold down shift and click anything we want to add to the selection. So now we know the basics of selecting things, but how do we actually move around our scene? So again, one of the main ways we navigate around our space is by orbiting. And this just means revolving around our scene. And to do this, just hold down your middle mouse button and move around. Another type of motion we can do is panning, which just means sliding around our view. And to do this, we basically just orbit, but this time hold down shift before using the middle mouse button. So already we have two types of navigation that use the middle mouse button, and as you might have expected, zooming in and out is just scrolling the mouse wheel up and down. And this will take some time to get used to, but the main lesson here is that navigation is done with the middle mouse button. But there's actually another way to navigate the 3D viewport that can be done with just a trackpad. So on the top right, you see we have a gizmo and a couple extra buttons. And if we drag around this gizmo, you see that we're orbiting around our scene. So this is the equivalent of an orbit. And immediately to the left, we have this magnifying glass, which we can click and drag to zoom in and out. So obviously, this is the equivalent of a zoom. And lastly, we have this hand icon, which we can click and drag to pan around. So this is our equivalent of panning. And notice that our gizmo is actually updating as we orbit around manually using the middle mouse button. So this will always match the orientation we have in our viewport. And this actually leads me to the reason that you'd even use a gizmo if you have a mouse. So suppose we want to look at our scene coming from this direction, which is to say coming from the right side of our green y-axis. Well, to do this, all we have to do is click the green right handle in our gizmo, and this gives us a side view of our scene. If instead we wanted to look at the top of our scene, we can just click the top blue handle in the gizmo, and this gives us a bird's eye view on the scene. So this method can be used to go to the front, back, left, right, top, and bottom views very easily. And I want to mention one more thing about navigation before we move on. So let's say that for some reason we want to orbit around our camera object. Well, notice that no matter how much we try to orbit, we're fixed on the center of the scene. And this doesn't really feel that natural. Instinctively, we want to orbit around wherever our mouse is hovering. And there's actually a setting that forces Blender to do this. So to find the setting, go to the Edit dropdown and then open up our Preferences window. Now, since this is a navigation-based issue, we're going to go to the Navigation tab, and then you want to enable Auto Depth. And now you see that our orbiting is acting in a way that makes more sense. So now we actually have all the tools we need to navigate around our 3D viewport. So our first objective is now complete, and we want to switch our attention over to moving, rotating, and scaling our objects. So back in the default scene, we only want our cube, which means we need to delete the other objects. So again, click an object to select it, and then shift-click the other to add it to the selection. And there are many ways to delete your selection, like hitting delete on the keyboard, right-clicking and then selecting delete, or using the Blender hotkey for deleting, which is just X. And now that we've isolated the cube, I want to look over at the toolbar, which we can enable and disable using T. And right now by default, we have our selection tool chosen, but let's switch over to the move tool. And when we do this, we get the move gizmo placed over our selection. And we can drag any of our arrows to move our cube across the X, Y, or Z axis. You can also drag these little squares to move around two axes at once, and if we drag outside our gizmo, we're going to end up moving perpendicularly to our view. Some other tricks are holding down shift while using the gizmo to slow down the movement, and this can be very useful whenever we want to make small, precise movements. And another trick is holding down control to move incrementally. So as you might expect, these ideas extend over to rotation and to scaling. So now let's select our rotation tool, and we can rotate by choosing an axis and making a circular motion with our mouse. And just like last time, you can hold down shift to slow things down or control to rotate incrementally. And we can do this on any of the axes, or we can just select other parts of our gizmo to get a free rotation. And now switching over to the scale tool, we can scale on one axis at a time or two at a time by clicking the small squares. When we select outside our gizmo, we get a uniform scaling on all three axes. And again, we can hold down shift to scale slowly or hold down control to do it incrementally. Now, one way to combine all of these together is by choosing the transform tool, which basically has all three gizmos packed into one. So this lets us use all the basic transformations in one convenient place. Now, when we're using Blender, we want to do things as quickly as possible. And while the toolbar is very useful, it's not really the fastest way to work. Instead, we use hotkeys for pretty much everything. So now I'm going to show you how to move, rotate, and scale objects the fast and efficient way. To move an object, the hotkey is G for grab, and automatically we're moving our object perpendicularly to the view. If we want to constrain this movement to one axis, we can hit X for the X axis, Y for the Y axis, or Z for the Z axis. And notice that as we're moving the cube, Blender tells us how much we're displacing it by. And we can actually type in values for this movement, and it will automatically be moved by exactly that distance. You can put in positive numbers, negative numbers, or even decimals. And just like before, we can hold down shift after clicking G, and we'll get slow, precise movement. Or we can hold down control to get incremental movement. So this is already much faster than using the movement gizmo. And we also have hotkey shortcuts for rotation and for scaling. So hit R to rotate your selection, and we can hit X, Y, or Z to choose our axis of rotation. Again, we can hold down shift to slow this down or control to do it incrementally. For scaling, the hotkey is S, and we can choose an axis in the same way. And if we don't choose an axis, the scaling will be uniform, and we can hold down shift to slow things down or control to do it incrementally. Now scaling has one more trick we can use, which is scaling on two axes at once. So for example, we can hit S for scale and then shift Z to scale on everything except the Z axis. We can also do the same type of thing with shift X and shift Y. So now that we can navigate and quickly do basic transforms, let's try making the Tower of Hanoi model, which was the goal for this tutorial. So let's start off by selecting our light and camera by shift clicking, and we can delete these with X. And I want to turn this cube into the base of the tower, so we need to reshape it so it looks like a thin board. So S and then Y to scale it on the Y axis, and let's also widen it a bit on the X axis. Now we want this to be a lot thinner than it is right now, and we can do that by S and then Z to scale down on the Z axis. And I'm making sure to say a lot of these hotkeys out loud so it really gets ingrained because they're really important. So now I'm going to change over to the side view using our gizmo, and I want to make this base look a bit more complex. And we can do that by just adding another layer to the base using another cube. But since we already have this one here, it'd be nice to duplicate it. And one very intuitive way to do this is just with Ctrl+C for copy and Ctrl+V for paste. And right now we can't see the cube that we added because it's perfectly overlapping with our original. So let's just move this down to Z axis with G and then Z until they're barely overlapping. And I want the second layer to be a bit bigger, but also slightly thinner. So if we scale and then hit Shift+Z, we are scaling on the X and Y axes. And then we can make it thinner by scaling down on the Z axis, and we should bring this back up so they're overlapping. So we have the base, and now we need to add three pegs, which are just cylinders. And to add a cylinder, we just go to the Add dropdown, and under Mesh, we just select Cylinder. And the faster way to do this is with the hotkey Shift+A to add, and then again, choose Cylinder. So now in the side view, let's bring up our peg so it's hovering over the board. And I want our cylinder to have a smaller radius, so we can just scale with Shift+Z so it preserves its height. And then just make this a bit taller so it looks more like the peg that you'd find in the Tower of Hanoi. So now we need one more peg on either side, so Ctrl-C and Ctrl-V to duplicate our cylinder, and then move it over to the left. And if we want another way to do this, we can hit Shift-D to duplicate, and this duplicates our cylinder and puts it in a free transform. So just hit Y to constrain it to the Y-axis, and then bring that over. You see that very quickly we've made the base and the three pegs, and now we just need the pieces that you move around. So let's add another cylinder, and then in the side view, let's rescale this and bring it up so it's in position. And for the rest of these pieces, we just need to make each smaller than the last. So duplicate our piece with Shift-D and bring it up on the Z-axis. And I'm going to decrease the radius with Shift-Z so the piece preserves its thickness. And let's just repeat this process one more time to get the next piece. And we can just keep repeating this process over and over again, or we can try something a bit smarter. So I'm going to select all our pieces by Shift-clicking, and we can repeat the same process, but this time it will work on all the pieces at once. So this trick just lets us work a lot faster. And we can make this look a bit more interesting by bringing some of our pieces to the other pegs. And in this one, you see that we're getting some overlap we don't want, so I'm just going to cheat and bring down the radius a bit more. So just keep using these methods to add more pieces until you feel like it looks complete. And at this point, I'm pretty happy with what we've got, and I want to rotate the entire thing so we can see it as a whole. So the hotkey for selecting everything is A, or you can just click and drag to select everything. And with our rotate tool, we can use this gizmo to view our entire model. So we used only primitive objects, the cube and the cylinder, and basic transforms like moving, rotating, and scaling to create something with more complexity. And again, we were able to make this using only the core fundamentals. And you should try making some other objects using these techniques, like a snowman, a bookshelf, or anything like that. But this has been the first part of Blender for Beginners, and I hope you guys join me on the next one. And if you want to fund more high-quality tutorials like these, consider donating on the CGMatter Patreon. It really helps me make these tutorials, and you can get some perks like behind-the-scenes content and the full scripts I write for these videos. But anyways, thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.